from where I was to his domain, it seems so far. I cried, dear Lord, I cannot come to where you are. He came to me. He came to me when I could not come to where he was. He came to me. That is why he died on Calvary. When I could not come to where he was, he came to me.
He came to me when I was bound in chains of sin.
Safe travels or going back to wherever they're going. We want to remember them, and we want to remember all of those who are sick, all the number that are still here that are sick. And we want to remember all of those people in Ukraine, and we want to remember all those around us in this country that can't fend for themselves. And we want to remember them as well. And we want to remember Pastor Chuck as he brings the message this morning to us. And we pray that the Lord speaks to him through us. Oh Lord our God, we thank you for all that you do. We praise you for your goodness. We praise you, Lord, for this time that we can just gather together and worship you. We thank you, Lord, that you draw us to this place to worship you. And even though, Lord, during the week that is not set up as a church, this is what we call it today. And we want to praise you and thank you for all that you do. Lord, we thank you for all the people that are here. And those, Lord, who are getting ready to leave us, pray that you would touch each one of them. Give them safe travels, Lord, as they go back to wherever they're going. Lord, we thank you for their lives and what they mean to us. Pray, Lord, that you would continue to touch them. And all those, Lord, who are still here, that remain, Lord, pray, Father, that you would touch each one of us and help us to serve you better. To share your words with those around us. To bring us closer, bring us all closer to you. And we pray, Father, that you would be with the people of Ukraine. Touch them, Lord, in this war-torn time. Father, we pray, too, for all those that are in this country that need a special touch from you. Whoever they are, whatever their needs, Lord, the sick, the afflicted, the poverty-stricken, those, Lord, who we can help, help us, Lord, to help them. And those, Lord, that we can't help, we pray for them. And I pray just now, Lord, a special touch on Pastor Chuck as he brings us the message this morning. Pray, O Lord, that you would anoint his lips and touch him, Lord, to break the bread of life to us. We thank you and praise you, Lord, for bringing you back to us. Father, be with us as we sing praises to you this day. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing our first song, At the Cross, At the Cross.
Might I hide my blushing face while his the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I could see my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much. Glory to his name.
Glory. the name of Jesus. Lead me to Calvary.
Of suffering and shame.
and Good Friday. But without them, we would all be lost. Aren't you glad that he did that for us? Because we would just be so lost. I can't imagine where we would be. We would just be sinners saved by grace. Gentlemen, come please. As the offering is being taken. For by grace are you saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God, lest any man should boast, the word tells us. And that gift we've been singing about, and it's the cross, the blood that was shed for us.
Amen.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome. It's so nice to see everybody here this morning, all those smiling faces and a few grumpy ones, too. We'll get over it. It's been a long time since I've been here. It's 8 months since I last preached. And, you know, after 8 months, it's been a long time. But I thought back this afternoon, or this day, about coming here the last time I preached, end of July, and we were getting ready to go on vacation. And it was so exciting and so thrilling to preach once and then to take off for a great vacation. And so I want to talk to you a little bit this morning about me, about that vacation experience and what was happening on that vacation, and then coming back to be with you. And then we'll talk about your life and about your vacation, or about your life and how it's going to be. And then we're going to talk about resurrection, his story, and his love for us as we think about that. Let me talk a little bit about it, the Bible verse to begin with. Psalm 42 verse 5 says, "My soul, why are you downcast? Why are you so disturbed? Put your hope in God, for yet I will praise him, my Savior and my God." I want you to think about that verse for a few moments. Think about the beauty of that particular verse. The psalmist says his soul is downcast and disquieted. His soul is downcast, disquieted, disturbed. Something going on in that psalmist's life, something that he needs to take care of, something that he needs to be healed from, something he needs to understand about his own life. And then he says, "For I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God." And then he says, "I have a Savior and I have a God." No matter what's going on in my life, no matter what I'm feeling like, no matter what the difficulty is in my life, I have a Savior and a God. I want you to think about that for a few moments as we get into this message for today, because that's really my message. I have a Savior and a God. And my soul was disturbed, my soul was downcast, my soul was in struggle, I couldn't sleep, I couldn't be awake, you know what I mean? Awake but not awake. And I was disturbed and downcast. And I had to have a soul, I had to have a Savior and a God to take me through what I had to go through. Let's talk about that for a few moments. You know, it started out as a good vacation. We were looking forward to having meeting new friends, seeing new people, seeing all kinds of people, all kinds of land and all kinds of beauty and landscape. And it was a great plan for a vacation. And so I thought about a Bible verse that might fit that very well. It was a verse that from Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, the Lord," declares the Lord, "plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and the future." Plans. I had all kinds of plans. We have all kinds of plans. Plans for a fun time, plans for a vacation. I know what a vacation is. Well, we were serious relatives for a while there. I was a good vacation. We were a good vacation, a fun time on a vacation, where something happened. We found hope defined differently. We found hope in sickness. Sickness entered into the picture and changed the whole concept of hope for our lives. On the ninth day of our trip, we stopped and we had a reserved camping spot that we had in North Dakota. Anybody here from North Dakota? Too bad. We stopped in North Dakota at a Roosevelt National Park. And we stopped there with our trailer, and we had our reserve spot. And everything was going well. And we went outside. I went outside to hook up the utilities outside and hook up the water and hook the sewer. Now, I don't know if this kind of ties them together, but when I was hooking up the sewer, I didn't feel so good. I don't know if that really ties together. No? Anyway, I didn't feel so good. In fact, things were happening that I didn't really understand. I couldn't remember things. I couldn't walk. I couldn't talk. Things were altogether confused. And I got up inside the trailer and felt my way around the back to the front door. And Connie met me at the front door, my wife met me at the front door, and said, "What's wrong?" I said, "I don't know." And she had to come out and push me up on the steps and push me up and under the couch inside the trailer. And first of all, I thought I was dehydrated, so I drank a lot of water. But suddenly things became confused, and I couldn't understand what was going on. And so we decided to call 911. Now, this area of North Dakota was rather non-populated. And so what they did is they came, but they were all volunteer people. And it was a small town, about 140 people. And the first man pulled up in a pickup truck. I thought to myself, I got to go to the hospital, I'm going to ride in the back of the pickup truck. And he took my vitals, and everything seemed okay. And then a few minutes later, the ambulance came. And two volunteer ladies helped. They had jeans on and vest, like a jacket on, to show that they were hospital people and emergency people. And they helped me with to see what was going on, and they checked my vitals, and they were okay. And they said, "You seem to be fine, but you better go to the hospital to get checked out. So we could drive you in an ambulance, not a pickup truck, and we could drive to the hospital, or you could drive yourself to the hospital, about 35 miles away." And so we decided that we would drive, and my wife drove, and we drove to the hospital. At the hospital, they diagnosed a brain bleed. Now, if you know anything about strokes, you know that about 30% of the people who get this type of stroke have a brain bleed. It's not a, like a blocked artery that blocks your heart or your brain, but it's a brain bleed. My brain was bleeding, which is rather interesting. I knew nothing was up there, but it was bleeding. And so they took me into the hospital, and they checked it out. They realized that it was more than they could handle because it was a small hospital in Dickinson. And they flew me to Bismarck by helicopter, about a 35-minute flight to Bismarck. The flight was good, only one problem, no peanuts. I figure for $20,000 I paid for the flight, nothing. So I got there, and long story short, they got me to the hospital, they checked me out, and it began a series of therapy and recovery. And therapy and recovery for the next months until now. This therapy is a recovery for me. A stroke. One of the things that you thought would never happen to you. A stroke. I couldn't walk. I couldn't talk. My legs felt like a ton of bricks. My voice didn't sound right. Still doesn't sound right today. My voice, I couldn't speak. You know what it's like for a preacher not to speak? You know, old preachers never died, and so on and on and on. But I couldn't go on and on. I couldn't say anything. I couldn't speak. Also, I couldn't remember places, people, even forgot the name of my grandkids. Some are here today. I couldn't remember their names. I couldn't remember other names. I kept remembering my address. My address from Illinois, not the address in Arizona. And it was freaky. It was something I hadn't planned on. But hope was redefined for me. 1 Thessalonians 1:3 says, remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope. Your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. Suddenly, vacation turned into a day-by-day, hope-filled recovery process. Life would take on new meaning. Despair and recovery would take on new meaning. And hope in the Lord would take on new meaning. 3 verses reminded me of it. Proverbs 13:12, hope deferred makes the heart sick, and a longing will fill the tree of life. Romans 8:25 says, but if we hope for what we do not yet hear, wait for it patiently. Romans 12:12, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Let me run those verses by you one more time. Proverbs 13:12, hope deferred makes the heart sick, but longing fulfills the tree of life. Down deep inside is longing for hope, but hope can be deferred. When hope's deferred, there's no life. When hope is there, there's life, the tree of life. Romans 8:25, but if we hope what we do not yet have, and wait for it patiently, hope is always there for us. Hope in the Lord is there for us each day. Hope in the Lord does not change. Other things may change, but hope in the Lord does not change as we continue to look to Him. And Romans 12:2 says, be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Be joyful in hope. Even in the midst of struggle, midst of problems, be joyful. Be joyful. Not happy, joyful. Know that God is there to bless you and guide you and take you through life, no matter what the pain might be. Be patient in affliction. A lot of patience comes when you have a stroke. Things don't work right. Things may never work right again. But I have to be patient, and I have to work through it as they go through life, and take them in prayer. Keep praying to God. Seek His face. Seek His grace. Seek His love. You see, I'm not done yet. I have therapy to do yet. I have recovery to do yet. But I'll do it, because God is there. And I hope. And because there's hope, there's promise. There's promise. There's life eternal. And because of that, I have hope there is a God. That's my story. I'm sticking to it. What about your story? What's your story this morning? What are you feeling like this morning? give hope. Give hope that things will work out okay, things will get better. Give hope in His promises. Give hope in that no matter what's happening in life, things will work out. Give dreams. Dreams for your future. Do you have plans for your future? You're going to go on a wonderful vacation in your future? Do you have plans for your life? Is it sad? Disappointment today, what you're going through? Do you have an open road before you? Or the road that's going down that seems like a dead-end road? Blockade, that you're going nowhere. We all have those days, good and bad days, days of struggle, days of pain, days of joy, days of happiness. We all have those struggles, we all have those days. But there is something that reminds us that it's never a dead end, it's never over, it's never finished. We have a God who loves us, a God who cares for us. We have a God whom we can turn to. We have a God who is there in our life. In a couple weeks, we're going to celebrate Easter. I'm sorry, I won't be here for Easter, but in a way that's good for you. I spit at Easter. I get excited at Easter. So you'll be happy that I won't be here. But Easter, Jesus rising from the dead. Jesus rising from the dead. Jesus rising from the dead. He's alive. He's alive. Not dead, not a tomb. Every other prophet, every other teacher, every other leader of faith around the world is dead. You want to see their tomb? Go and find it. The Olivet address. It's a cemetery. Our Savior rose. Jesus died. He rose again. You know, the world is going to celebrate Easter in a few weeks. It's celebrated by having bunnies who lay chocolate eggs. Bunnies who lay chocolate eggs. I never could figure that out. Of all the things that you would have for a celebration, bunnies laying eggs. That's supposed to give us hope. Ultimate hope comes in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let me share with you five things quickly about hope that we can have in Him. First of all, the resurrection gives us hope, complete hope. Our sins are forgiven. Listen to what Jesus said before He died. I'm going to the cross to pay for sins. I'm going to suffer and die. After 3 days, I will rise again and prove to you I am who I am. There's two significant things in those verses to remember. I'm going to the cross to pay for your sins. I'm going to rise and prove that I am who I am. Two significant things. Why? If Jesus didn't do the second one, rise, and the first one is a waste of time. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, the first one is a waste of time. If I told you, if that's a Chuck, going to die for your sins, and I told you to write them all down on a piece of paper, and I will go to the Grand Canyon, and I will jump off the edge of the Grand Canyon, and I will die for your sins, what will happen? When they scrape my body out of the Grand Canyon, your sins are still there, because I'm not the Savior. Jesus, Savior. He died. He gave life for you. And he jumped off the Grand Canyon. Learned that you would be saved. He died. And he rose again. And that's the mystery of the great resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We go through life. We're not perfect. We have regrets and remorse. We wish that things could be different. We wish that we had done different things in our life. But God doesn't want us there. God doesn't want you to stay there. God wants to forgive you. God wants to love you. God's love is perfect and it is real. Second thing, the resurrection gives us hope. Hope that we're no longer afraid to die. Throughout my illness, I was not afraid to die. At one point, I had a seizure. I lost consciousness for about a minute. When I woke, there were four doctors and six nurses working on me. By the way, in that minute, I didn't hear any music, I didn't hear any heavenly sounds, and there were no angels. So I wasn't dead, just a seizure. Okay. And when I woke, to ordinary people. But I was not afraid to die. Jesus was there. And Jesus said, you might have life. So whether I live, whether I die, I'm with the Lord, as Paul said. Whether I live, whether I die, the Lord will take care of me. In Jesus Christ, we have that hope. Jesus lived. Jesus died. And Jesus rose again. And because he rose again, I don't have to be afraid of death. You don't have to be afraid of death. We don't have to be afraid of death. We have the light of Jesus Christ for us in this life. Third thing, Jesus, the reason for the resurrection of hope is that God will never, 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 never stop loving us. Did I say never? He never will stop loving us. John 31:3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. What is everlasting? One of the greatest stories of everlasting is the story of two Pikes Peak. One here and one here. And every 1,000 years, a sparrow flies from this Pikes Peak over this Pikes Peak and sharpens his bill on this Pikes Peak and flies back. Everlasting is the time it takes for that sparrow sharpening its beak to wear down this Pikes Peak. That's incomprehensible. That's God's love. That's the way God takes care of us. We have that hope, we have that promise. Fourth, the reason the resurrection gives us hope is simply this. For our followers of Jesus Christ, we have significance and purpose. You know, not long ago I just was listening to the television, watching television, and I read something, or I saw something where Aaron Rodgers, football quarterback for the Green Bay Packers, received the highest payment for any NFL player in the United States now. And I read where Tom Brady came out of retirement and was going to go back and play with Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And I read where I saw where Russell Wilson was going to go to the Denver Broncos and help out Denver Broncos. And it became very significant events. But what is that compared to significant events that you and I are called children of God? All the money, all the prestige in the world does not match that. Children of God, we have purpose and we have meaning, we have hope, We have purpose. We are a children of God. Psalm 138, verse 8 says, "The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me because he loves me. His love endures forever." And Mark 8 says, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your old way, take up your cross and follow me. If you hang on your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me and for the sake of the good news, you'll save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world and lose your own soul? If anything's worth more than your soul, if anyone is ashamed of me and my message and these adulterous and sinful days, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory of his Father and his holy angels." Can you hear those words for a minute? What do you do? What do you benefit if you gain the whole world, lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Anything? Highest contract? Greatest fame in the world? Your soul worth more. And your soul belongs to Jesus Christ, who gave his life for you, who died and rose again, as your Lord and your Savior. Follow Christ. Look to him. Make each day a special day because you belong to Christ, and give your life to him each day. And a fifth thing, and final thing, the resurrection hope gives us eternal life. Heaven. The last of the 12 disciples was John. Romans wanted to poison him, get rid of him like the other 12 who were martyred, the 11 who were martyred. And John said, no, he found a way out of it. And they shipped him to Patmos, the island in the Mediterranean. And there he wrote a book. It's called Revelation. He gets a glimpse into heaven. He sees heaven. And it's hard for him to explain. You read the book just from that angle. And he has a hard time explaining what he sees because it's so grand, it's so beautiful, it's so wonderful. He has a hard time explaining it. It's like the song I once heard. And it goes like this. Heaven is a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. I want to see my Savior's face. Because heaven is a wonderful place. Anybody know that song? Yeah, good, good. It's an old song. And so are you. But it says, heaven is a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. And you go through that song. It goes faster, faster. Heaven's a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. I want to see my Savior's face. Heaven's a wonderful place. It goes all faster and faster and faster and faster. Until finally it ends with, because heaven is a wonderful, heaven is a wonderful, heaven is a wonderful place. Yeah. Yeah. At the end of all this stuff we go through, heaven is a wonderful place, filled with glory and grace. I'm going to see my Savior's face, because heaven is a wonderful, heaven is a wonderful, heaven is a wonderful place. Yeah. So, my story, your story, our story, it all belongs to him. He gives meaning, he gives a purpose, he gives us life, gives us hope. His story. Yes, we can be a part of resurrection because his story is our story in Jesus. Celebrate that message. want to celebrate communion this morning. There's no greater meal than you and I can have this morning than the meal of the Holy Communion. Because in his body, in his blood, we have hope, we have promise, we have grace that can fill our heart, our soul. We have forgiveness, we have hope, we have promise that can fill our soul, and we have Christ who fills our life. So in a few moments, you will come and you receive his body and blood in the form of bread and juice. And you are asked to remember one thing, remember him who died for you and gave his life for you. And so remember the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, when he said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you," Paul says. Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And we proclaim his death for us until he comes again. Come now to receive the Lord's Supper. Take and eat the true body of Christ. Take and drink the blood of Christ. in the body and blood of Jesus Christ, call to remembrance the death of Jesus Christ for you and for me. And that death of Jesus Christ at the resurrection, they rose for you and me. And we have that promise, both now and until we get to heaven. We see him face to face. We have the eternal meal with him. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your love for us. We thank you for hope, hope beyond hope, that you are there for us, that you died and rose again, that we may have life and have it to the fullness. And when we go, as we go from here, we go with the power of your grace and your love for us. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.